Star South Asia Aronax International. Ma'am, may I request you to come on stage?
I would like to call upon Dr. Archana Srivastav, Director in Charge, Balaji Institute of Modern Management, to welcome our guest to the podium. We will now call upon Gaurav Gupta, Student Manager, Balaji Institute of International Business, to introduce our guest.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I feel great honor in introducing amongst us Ms. Deepthi Das, South Asia Head HR for Aronax International. Ma'am is an ICF PCC coach, MBTI assessor, ISAB lab certified professional, having an academic journey in production management, marketing and human resource. Ma'am is an alumni at Tata Institute of Social Science and IIM Ahmedabad. Along with being associated with Society of Human Resource Management, ma'am is also one of the founder member of the women's wing of Bombay Chamber of Commerce. With more than 17 years of corporate career, she has been associated with brands like RPG Group, Taj Mahal Hotel and Reebok India. Her multi-discipline and multi-industry kaleidoscope has helped her immensely to try radical reaches of continuously looking at business challenges and opportunities from a micro and macro point, trying to make HR business scalable. With more than 2 years of leadership journey at Aronax International, ma'am won the first HR award stating the transformational journey will begin and going on. Ma'am, I now request you to enlighten us with your words of wisdom. The stage is all yours. Thank you.
The two students who did escort me and have been doing their best since yesterday. This is an investment of time that each one of you is making, your institute is making, your faculties are making, and of course I'm making it. And there's a reason why each one of us from the corporate have been called in here. So what you get out of the session, I'm not going to do a monologue. I purposely did not bring a presentation because I'm not going to brand my company and sell my company. That's not what I'm here for. It's not a pre-placement talk. I'm not going to be telling you best practices of my company on a slide because you people are managers yet to be. So you cannot apply something which I'm already applying in the in my company across the region. It will not make sense. So let's talk something which will make sense to you all and which you all can take back. How many first years and how many second years, please? First years? All right. More concentrated here and here. And the others are second years, right? Excellent. All right. Now, what we're going to do is, there is a whiteboard here. And who's going to help me out? What we're going to do is, we're going to be doing a simple expectation mapping as to what we want to talk about in this next 1 hour that we have. All right? Does that sound fair enough?
Yes.
All right. Now, one of you is going to come here and help me jot what we want from the session. Who's going to be the volunteer? Funny? Whoever wants to be the volunteer can raise their hand, please. Everybody's feeling hungry, I know. Alright, please. May I have your name? Karthik. Thank you. Can we just have a round of applause for Karthik? And when I spoke to the professor, he said that probably we could keep a theme of the agile business world today, right? So we start here in proper agility. Agility means that you have to have the ability to have no pattern and yet deliver. So therefore, I said I will not have a PPT. I will talk at this interface what you all want. Because that's going to be your business environment. And if I am the company, that's what is going to be the environment that you're going to get into. Right? Now, you have him come up. Again, the second layer. You need to be agile. Why didn't the second layer come in? I'm not asking a question, I'm just saying. This is what you and me have been bred into. And we're going into an environment and we are fast moving into an environment which is requiring agility at all levels. We could have had a second year here, but we didn't. Now, we've got to get into such elementary levels of thinking and applying. What is the business jargon or a business term that the industry is talking about? What does it mean? How does it apply to me? How do I use it to benefit? Makes no sense, makes sense. I won't want a silent audience, believe me. It's the most boring thing to be sitting as a student there and having somebody just deliver what, you know, I'm not doing my autobiography, so it needs to be interactive. So, what do we expect from the session? Can we put it down? Can we help him jot it down for us? You're going to have to be interactive, believe me, otherwise, yes please.
How to survive in the future environment.
How to survive in the future environment, alright? Yes please. Just one request, let's start respecting ourselves, we're going to the corporate world. Let's start here, please share our names. I know everybody knows you, but I do not. Can we just share our names and then what we want to talk about? Yes, please.
Ma'am, name Lakshitar. I am from VIB Marketing.
Thank you.
In this session, we are going to discuss innovations which are coming in India.
Innovations, business innovation, business environment. Okay. You were saying something. I stopped you anyway, you got up, yes? The gentleman on, no, next to you. Yes, you were saying something? No, all right. Anybody else? Yes, please.
My name is
Mulu. Mulu, yes, please.
My name is Mulu Ghosh. I'm from Telcombat.
Yes.
The discussion that we would like to have over here would be, like, since the technology is changing, what are the best possible ways to get ourselves adapted, you know, to the changing environment of changing technology?
Okay, so you said we want to know, so I assume there's a certain section of your friends who want to know the same. Alright, no issues. Alright, so how do I as a manager or a prospective employee and a manager behave in an ever-changing world? Is that correct? Okay, anything else? Yes.
Hello.
Hi.
Madhuri,
yes. What company looks for in a fresher? Attitude or skill set or education background? They told me because either the throats are dry or the attention span is going. Anything else anybody wants to know? Yes,
from your personal academics to corporate journey, because what I really think is we can learn more from someone else's experiences. So academics to corporate journey of yours.
So if I rephrase that question, I have a multidisciplinary background, so how did I make a transition, and did I make a transition by design or default, and how did it assist me? Does that answer your question in a more concrete manner?
Yes.
Okay. Anything else, please? Yes, please.
Good morning, ma'am. My name is Pumong Chheda. I'm from BIA Batch. And my question to put up is, how to face peer pressure in organizations.
How to face peer pressure?
Yes.
Can you be a little more explicit?
In a way, like there are many more phases, like how we come up in a situation, we don't want to do some things, but we are good to do.
You are forced to do.
We are forced to do.
Okay.
Like suppose for an event. We are facing up the challenge. I'm not supposed to go on the stage, but on the stage fear, I have the stage fear, and there are many other possibilities where I can't express myself. So
and you're forced to go there.
Yes.
Up on the stage.
Yeah.
Okay. So how to handle the discomfort because of fear pressure? Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
Ma'am, over here, on your right. Yes.
Yes, please.
If we look to India, Devang Rajgur from
Bank
of
Finance. Yes.
If we look at India, India is a major chunk of unorganized sector.
Yes.
And these days we are talking on technologies such as IoT and big data.
Yes.
So there's a huge gap between an unorganized sector and this technology development. How to make them come together and how to make it a better way to, or how to resolve it?
Or should I say, do we use it in our organized sector? Yes, no? And are we going to use it? Yes, no? Should I put it that way? That's going to raise the gap, right?
I want to say that we should actually use it, because even Narendra Modi won his election on the basis of leveraging this big data. So it can also help the unorganized sector as well. So how do we use it? And unorganized.
How do you use it? And why don't you use it? Okay. So are we using big data enough or predictive analysis enough? And if you're not, then more than how, I would say, what is the approach so that we can start using it? Yes? Because how becomes a very specific to a business or a function application. So I would refrain from that. I'll give you some examples, but I would refrain from that. That's a very domain specific. Yes, please.
I'm Shwati Behil. And my question is, what do you think, is there still something known as a glass ceiling in the corporate world, like, have you ever come across something like this?
Have I ever been facing the glass ceiling? I remember the director's question. Okay. Yeah. I was planning when she asked it. Anybody else, please? Yes.
Ma'am, my name is Shomak Banerjee.
Yes.
And I wanted to ask, what are the prospects for the logistic industry with the growth of the e-commerce business?
What is the prospect of the logistics industry, okay?
With the growth of e-commerce business.
Yes. Today, in the environment, e-commerce or the e-logistics. Yes. Okay. All right. Yes. I would say, if I rephrase your question, how can I apply my know-how or my learnings of hospitality industry into business? Business. International business, domestic business, international, it doesn't make a difference. HR department, production line, or marketing or branding doesn't make any difference. Business is business. Okay? All right. I'll tell you why I say that. Why I corrected you and said, let's look at business and rather than just international business. I'll tell you why I said that. Anybody else? Anything else?
Hi, good afternoon, ma'am.
Good afternoon.
My name is Arindam Kumar and I'm from BIKF Telecom.
Yes.
Ma'am, as you are head HR, where do you see human resource 10 years down the line? As the coming era...
10 years?
Yeah.
We're talking about tomorrow.
As the coming
you
era...
You people are asking a long-term question. It's like really shocking. Okay, all right.
Actually, as the coming era is of IoT and artificial intelligence.
Okay. Even I don't plan for 10 years. I plan this year's IDP. IDP, everybody knows, and simplicity, the individual's development plan. I plan for my individual development plan for every year. I don't plan for 10 years. But still, I'll tell you what is the future. Yes.
Good afternoon, ma'am. My name is Shyam Prasad.
Good afternoon.
I just wanted to know how is the Aramax selection process? And how do you want the candidates to appear and answer the interview questions?
Answer the interview questions?
Yeah.
Oh, you want a crash course on that? Somebody said, what do you expect from a fresher? I think I'll put it into the same piggyback because what I'm going to talk about is, as a professional, how do I see you as prospective employees? How are you going to be addressing or looking at that from your lens, and that will have shades of Aramex as a company that I presently work with also. Would that be all right?
Aramex.
Good afternoon. Hi. You want to share? No? Come on. If you're feeling hungry for lunch, then that's something else. Other than that, you can share. Nothing to share. That's a good thing and a bad thing. Then you're in void, you don't know what to take in and how to comfort in that. Okay, alright. Anybody else? No. Yes, no?
Good afternoon, ma'am.
Yes.
My name is Shivani Somkar from IIT. My question is, how to make visible in a newly joined organization?
How to make you as a brand visible in a new organization? Okay, great. Okay. Are we done?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Alright. Now, how many of us know what is, anybody's heard of VUCA? I'm sure everybody has. Okay. Some people that I interacted with did not know VUCA. What's the full form of VUCA? That is a nursery line going on. Okay. Alright. So, some of your friends or colleagues did not know the full form, and that's why I asked her. Now, we're standing in an agile VUCA world where everything is changing, right? I just came to Manipa where they said, is agility required for business and what's the relevance? And where is it relevant? Somebody asked me here that how is it impacting the logistics sector? Believe me, today everything with technology, it's riding a technology platform. So everything is agile. Irrespective of the function that department you're in, doesn't make a difference. Be it you an international, or be it you in a finance function, or an operations function, or if you're an HR function. Everything is piggyback on a platform that's technology driven. Today you're using data for predictive analysis, for everything. If you guys go to use a credit card, they're using that for predictive analysis. Every product line is using it. It is not today really constricted to what is your product and what is the segment that you're looking at. When I talked to your faculty, he said, let's talk about the aggregator model. Right? Everybody knows about the aggregator model, right? Yes, they said yes. The aggregator model, again, is today relevant because we're sitting in an agile world. Now, the aggregator model writes a technology platform and is very, very applicable to the e-com or the e-logistics sector. Because it gives you a better decision-making capability as y'all as a customer and us as business. It's used in different shapes. If you use a particular portal and it shows you back a certain SMS saying, hey, this discount is on, would you like to buy it? They're prompting you to buy it. What are they doing? They're reading a pattern, they're taking in all the data, they're reading a pattern, they're making a forecast of you as a consumer being able to be a prospective buyer, and that's why they're throwing back the data to you. Right? And that is exactly what an aggregator model broadly does it, even if certain business or products are taking it in bits and pieces. That's what an Uber does. That's what an Oyo Rooms does. That's what even a Policy Bazaar does. What does the advertisement say? How are they branding it? Save cost. Why are they saying that? Why are they saying that to y'all? They show somebody, a very young person, making a decision, and somebody who is his mother telling him. So what are they showing? They're targeting the agile workforce. Today's workforce, that's each one of you, and people who are past us just before this. What are they using? They're using the aggregator model. They're saying go to the platform, make a decision, be cost effective, and they're hitting on that particular emotion, which is what is high today in each one of us. Forget the business. We are the consumers of the business. What happens in business comes to us, because today we are moving from a B2B more to a
B2C.
Today the lag time is finished. That's what the aggregated model is more focused towards. That's what the VUCA world talks about. We heard of concept like just in time, right? Today everything is just in time. What's the aggregated model doing? Can we go back to our basics and try and apply it? Today is more of a point of sale. If your marketing glass is more of a point of sale at that point, aren't we doing that? All of these portals, look at Amazon or Flipkart, each one of them, what are they doing? They're doing that. But an actual aggregator model will say that I'll give you an analysis, which is what a Policy Bazaar and others do. That's a total end-to-end, right? Which helps you make a better decision. Which is what today, in terms of the data, they're using. Where's this gentleman who's asking for the data? He went out. So he said, how can you use it? So a company uses it for its product or service that it's selling. In the case of an internal business, you are using that to make a forecast of what the customer will be requiring and therefore make amends to your product line. If you're looking as an HR, which currently I am in, you're looking at forecasting and looking at what will the mobilization ratio be. This is all applicable to each function. It is more macro. It is not, and then we have to bottle down to a micro level. Does it make sense?
Yes.
And therefore, if I link it to, so what are they doing is they're utilizing every piece of the information, applying it for an output. So if I shift gears and go to the gentleman who said, how did you use your hospitality industry? Why are we segmenting information by industry? The industry never said that. Every industry gives you, like a canvas, a certain nuance which is dominant. So what did I apply? On the production line, I dealt with workers, but I dealt with a certain manner. The service quality spectrum increased when I went to hospitality. Right? The process still is from, if I'm looking at target audience and I'm segmenting it, from when I'm looking at a niche market and a mass marketing, so I'm looking at Abata and I'm looking at Swarovski, is I'm looking at the production line application to a premium segment, luxury brand, and hospitality industry application. That's the spectrum. Right? So I can use that at every point where I'm interacting with either my external customer or my internal customer. My service quality goes up. And service quality has data to back it up. Don't we have that? Right? So that's how you apply it. Because let's understand that we should never ever forget what our management initially, what we read in the first year. It's all an application of the macro dynamics that is impacting every company. How do I make my brand visible in the market? Everybody's aware of what is a USP, right?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Have you ever defined what is our USP?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, if I need to make my brand visible, I need to first and foremost look at what do I stand for? What do I want to stand for? We all have our strengths, right? We've been told time and time again, sometimes, like the Johari window, we have a blind spot. But some people have probably told that you're very good in it. And I've probably assessed over the years as a person, am I good in it? Yes, no. Can I make my list of USPs? Can I apply that not to a brand, and not when I'm sitting in the marketing team making an USP? Can I go to the whiteboard and make my own USP? Why do I ask what the company wants from me? First of all, what can I give to the company? Have I ever looked at that? So the agile world, again, talks about, can we become a little more accountable in this whole speed which is going up? Agility was always there. It's only the speed which is increasing because of the technology platform. How would I like to brand myself is what I need to see. Nobody else can ever see that. Because I will need to stand for my brand. Every brand, for example, ladies, which is the brand that you would love to use in healthcare products? I'm not going to say cosmetics, healthcare products. Amway. Okay. Okay, Body Shop? Okay. Alright. Anything else with the maids would like to associate with? Any brand? Nivea, okay, all right. Why do you want to associate with this brand? So what do you like about Amway? Can I have two things about Amway, what you like? Anybody? It's quality, okay? Brand name, why do you remember the brand name? What's behind it? When you say Amway, when you see Amway, what comes to your mind? It's a natural product, okay. It's an organic product, natural product. Anything else? There's a variety of, okay, there are a lot of choices that you have. What else? Pardon me? On main voice, spoke and then.
Ma'am, targeted needs of the customer. For every section, they have different products.
So, the thought of options, that's what. So, they got that. Okay. Now, understand this. The moment I speak of a brand, you immediately connect with it and you want that for the top two or three qualities that you think that it has and you would like to either be there or associate with it. A lot of times they're doing aspiration selling. Most of the times. You go in, you don't have the pocket money, you want a body shop product, but you still go and buy a body shop product. When you have cross path selling on one platform, like a lifestyle or a shop stop or whatever. Right? They're doing aspiration selling. You want to be there, you want to be associated with those brand qualities that the brand is selling. Exactly the same. What would you want people to associate you with? When they say, for example, let me go back a little into the social front. Have you ever heard people say, "Aap is khandan se hain?" Has anybody heard?
Yes, ma'am.
We've all heard. It's a difficult thing, we probably all of us have heard. What are we saying? What is that khandan? The khandan is the brand, and the way you behave are the brand values that you are living. So brand is nothing but the image that you create because of the brand values, which like a norm you continuously believe and behave on. So if you want to be going to a company of a particular brand and you associate the company with a certain amount, a certain number of brand values, and you want to be there, can you draw back on the whiteboard and look at yourself and see, as a manager who needs to live and be representative of that kind of a brand value, what do I have and how do I behave? In other fluffy words, a lot of times people call it the culture fit. Right? But the culture fit is nothing. A lot of times you might get rejected from an interview because somebody says, "You don't fit the culture." It just means you do not have an view what the brand value or the brand norm is. They don't connect with that you're going to be behaving or displaying that behavior when you're interacting. And as a brand ambassador, you're interacting with the internal customers, that's your fellow employees, either leading to their performance or not helping them in their performance. You're interacting with, maybe if you're in the branding, you're interacting with external customers, either leading to the bottom line or not leading to the bottom line. If you're in the sales, you either assist the top line or you don't assist the top line, or you get a sales lead and you convert it or you don't convert it. So it has far-reaching repercussions than just saying that I want to work in a brand and they said that it doesn't, you know, there's no culture fit. There's more to it, there's more data, there's more meaning to that than just saying it's not a culture fit. So when you're supposed to brand yourself, please do that simple exercise and that nobody else can do but you. You will be getting continuous feedbacks not only on your assessments that you have, but today teachers are not just mentors, you will have your faculties as coaches giving you direction. You are not students from 10 years or 15 years back. Today we're talking about adult education. You are not kids, you are sitting in an MBA program, you are going through a form of adult education where your faculties are mentoring you. So they are continuously giving you a feedback. Which is what also happens in an organization when you have a performance appraisal. It's the same thing. But a lot of times we don't take it here because while we get our ratings, we are not rated on that, we don't give it that amount of due. If you were to give that due, you will find it as an input into building your brand image and see that your brand values, which you think you live and you want to aspire to be and live, whether you're reinforcing that, yes, no. And while we talk about technology, technology as a skill you can learn. This is something which you'll have to develop yourself. That you can pick up from the market, this you got. That's the difference. And the agile world comes with both. When sitting in a VUCA world, it comes with both. One is the data dynamics, one is what is sellable, and one is what the workforce needs to change in terms of the attitude or the approach. And somebody asked, what do you recruit for? The skill set, the attitude or the approach? Skill set is something that you pick up. Right? So if you're from a B school, some basic IQ you will have, it's a given. You will know something about each subject, it's a given. These are given. Otherwise, why come to a B school? So if that is set in place already, then what's the company looking for? The company is looking for an approach. Approach that, can you apply that? You get your subjects. What's the application? Can you apply it? Do you have the wherewithal to apply it? That is what a company is looking at. When I say
technology and
coming in, right? Have I looked at myself and say, as a manager, how can I apply it? How can I be an agile manager? I have a system, I have the budget, I pick it up, great. But I still need a man to run it, right? When I say man, I need a man or woman to run it. Am I making myself agile? Am I working on myself to use that? That is what a company looks at. If the system cannot do the work, then each or one of you will not be required, right? I will not be required. Who asked about what do you require, what do you look for? Asked you the approach, who asked? You asked, right? Does that answer your question? Kind of no, yes? If it's a no, you can tell me that. No, so you have to then help me rephrase that question so I can answer and try and attempt to answer your question.
Decrease that and save a cost.
That is what will be looked at. Yeah? What are the rest that we haven't yet picked up? Expectations. Adaptive technology is what I discussed earlier. I mean, be it predictive data, be it mobilization, each one of them. Today we're looking at predictive analysis in an organization, as I said. And we use that in the case if we had a succession plan or building talent. Let's say any one of you, a lot of you could say, I want to go to a company from a joinee, a management trainee, a manager level in the next years. Again, there I'm going to use my data to see as how you fared, what's the probability, what's the true, and this is where another approach is being used widely by companies, called as coaching. Did you know that CEOs are coached?
Okay.
So this is a term which we've all used and we've heard of in sports, right? But you have coaching of all sorts. How is it different from mentoring? Is there a difference between the two? Pardon me? I can't.
Mic, please.
The coach will say how to do it.
No. A coach never says what to do.
It is the most frustrating
in a coaching session. Because the coach never tells you what to do. The coach will assist you with the direction. Right? If you sit in front of a coach, and when we went through our certification, it was very exasperating. Because when we sat there, we are not told what you will have to do. Whenever we get blocked, so irrespective of the level you are in, you are a student, you get a blockage, you might have a manager and you think, I am capable of probably two promotions and I'm not getting it. Why am I not getting it? Right? Given that you have all the requirements which the next job has, even then you may be trying hard, but you're still not getting through. That's because somewhere you are not taking the right steps which you are supposed to take. Now, nobody better than you, and again I'm saying that's the agile world today, that each one of us in today's VUCA world needs to take that accountability himself or herself. I know how to do. The coach is going to give you a direction and is going to ask you. The power of questioning comes in there. Is going to keep asking you questions to help you discover what you want to do. And coaching is also something which there is a misnomer that it's something which is without results. Companies are investing in it and therefore it's not without results. It is something which has got a goal plan, it's got an action plan, and it has got at the end of your coaching period. Suppose you're looking for a promotion and let's say you have been picked up and you're being trained and developed for it, and how to make a transition from position A to position B. If you are coached, at the end of the day, it is with the fixed goal in mind that you're going to be a successor for XYZ. And you're going to be devising action plans for yourself with timeline. Again, the coach comes in play where the coach tells you, have you done it? Pushes you to achieve it. This is exactly what a sports coach does. How many sports coaches have been players themselves? You do not need to be. You are not a mentor. A mentor is somebody who is technically proficient. And therefore, you have mentors in the same department or the function. Because I know what is done, I have done it myself, I will assist you and guide you in that particular process, which is function specific or stream specific. Today, more and more in India, CEOs are getting coached. Today, more and more in India, managers are getting coached. And why do you think so? Is this a fashion which is coming from the West? Why do you think it's happening? Yeah? Changes?
It shows, and you know it. So even that's a question of it.
So that's the best way to deal with a peer pressure which you're talking about. But it's not so bad in the corporate, believe me. It's more how you approach it and you look at it rather than getting bogged down by it. It's not such a dirty, bad world in the corporate community. It's not. Yeah? And now I'll kind of come to the lady who said, well, glass ceiling. Who said the glass ceiling? You said glass ceiling. If there's a glass ceiling, I can make it. I always believe that. The glass ceiling is created by circumstances, yes. But as your corporate citizen, there was somebody talking to me earlier who asked, if you want to get it, you'll be able to get it. Tell me last, when you wanted something very bad, whatever it is. You really wanted it bad and you said, I'm going to get it, forget it. I don't understand who does it and who doesn't do it and who wants it, doesn't want it, I want it. What are the last such so badly needed thing by you? Other than a perfume, yeah. No splits. You wanted a split. Okay. And when you could not do it, to when you could do it, what is the time span? 4 months. How many times did you try and fail? 100 times, okay. I'm sure you must have done it 1,000 times and still then got where you did, because otherwise you would have never been able to get it in 4 months, right? And a perfect split at that. What does it teach you? What is the one thing that you did right with that? What did you do in that? Okay? What did you do? I want the action that you did. What did you do? You practiced. Okay? So, exactly the same thing. In the case of a glass ceiling, believe me, I've stood on the production floor and I've been in a batch where there were 15 of us and there were 13 guys and the final project was ripped up. And that's okay. That's fine. That's competition. That's an emotion that came out. I either said, I'll go to the faculty and say, well, how did you do that? Or I said, I took the second option. Either I said, excuse me, give me more time. And I don't know which of my fellow classmates did it. Right? That would not take me to my final project completion. The deadline was next volume, 8:30. So what I did, I chose the second option. I got what I needed. I got the lab open. I finished my project. I apologized for being in that kind of a sleepy state the next day. I presented what I needed to present. I finished it. What do you think the people who were so creative felt? The people who were so creative the last evening to have destroyed whatever I had done because I had finished it and I was topping the batch, what do you think they felt? When I finished it the next day along with them and I cleared my Viva, what do you think they felt? They would have killed me. Right? What do you think I felt? So some things, you need to do it smartly. You don't need to always lock your horns. Continue what you want to do. Have the perseverance, have the dedication. If somebody is really not a veteran, believe me, you will not have your best out. Right? You have something as a hurdle. Why do you think a hurdle is? So do you think a hurdle is there in, you have the Reebok Arabics, the transform classes. Do you think it's there? You heard of a hurdle in such classes? No? You heard about the difference? No? You have these hurdle exercises which are there in today. It is so prevalent in each of these, either the Reebok fitness centers that you have, where you use a lot of small hurdles. You induce it. Yeah? So it's like that. If you look at something which you talked about, the glass ceiling, if I looked at what I did at that decision, I looked at it as a hurdle. And a hurdle helps you dig out another dimension in you, which you did not yourself probably know. So I met a debate, the decision making, and even though I was a student, I acted like a business manager rather than a student. I chose to do that. Or I could have gone up to my faculty and said, you know what? You know what happened? An entire drama. Fine. I fell back. Yes, I'm human. But I acted like a future manager was expected to behave with the limited time to deliver what I needed to deliver. And then kept feeling bad about it. I think the glass ceiling applies only when you're not wanting to do it. I'm not saying there are a lot of opportunities which are given less. But that's a hurdle. Take it as a hurdle. That's it. Believe me, your counterparts, your male colleagues also have their hurdles, sets of hurdles. Believe me. It's not that only the ladies have it. Right? So if they can keep trying, why can't you keep trying? If you want it back, you'll get it. If you zero in on something, you'll probably get it after the fifth attempt if they get it at the first attempt. And that's all right. The day you reach that after the fifth attempt, then you look back. Fortunately, you would have matured in that process four more times versus your counterpart who got or arrived there on the first attempt and lost out on the maturity of the four. Right? What is process re-engineering? What is process re-engineering? Why is it done? So you've got to change your process. You have to re-engineer your process because certain parts of the process become obsolete. Right? Because they are not giving the output. Isn't that what you are doing? Isn't that what you're doing when you keep getting stuck? You have a process. Here you might have a production line or an output of a service or a product. Right? Here you have a need. If you look at that as the final output of the product which you are wanting, then aren't you doing the same thing when you're finding a buyer needed? Are you using each of your management skills there? I organize, I plan. I put an action plan, I have a cord chart. So the production flow, you look at the cord chart the moment you enter. It says everything and says that what is your output time going to be? Are you going to meet it or not? That's what you did. And that's what you do in the case of any goal that you're wanting. Even if it's a glass ceiling. It does exist, but you can always cross that and make your opportunities more if you look at yourself as a manager and not from a particular agenda. A work knows no agenda. And one thing that I will share with you is, and which I tell every lady employee whom I've ever worked with, that you're most welcome into the team. I'm not going to promote diversity, but I'm going to say equal chances. But please, first, if each one of us as a manager, not as a gender, stop sympathizing or discriminating ourselves and feeling that we are doing this and we are getting subject to this and we are getting subject to that. We promised ourselves we'll be managers. Manager means I manage with a limited resource. Manager means I manage with certain challenges. So why do we start looking at just the challenge and get scared with that and come back? Why do we do that? Who told us? Who taught us that? We promised and we took a pledge. Each one of you took a pledge when you entered the MBA Institute, am I right? That's when you're given a seat versus somebody else who wasn't given a seat. Let's understand each one of you are fortunate and your parents have put in a lot of efforts to put you in here. So who gave you the opportunity to put that into your head? You come here to become a manager. Please become a manager. Stop being kids. And that you can tell yourself, nobody else can tell you. And nobody should be telling you. You're all grown-ups. You're taking your own decisions in your personal life. And the same is applicable in the business world. There's nothing different. Because I worked across industries, be it the hotel industry, it's male dominated. Be it the footwear industry, it's male dominated. I worked on the production line in Delhi. How beautiful it is, I know. Yeah? So, I mean, you'll actually have somebody who doesn't know you're the production manager and comes and says, and you'll actually have to listen to that. Because he doesn't know that you're a production manager and you, that happens, that's reality. But what does it kind of deter you? No. That's okay. You're interested in the work. Talk a language of work. Don't talk a language anything else when you're in the work area. You'll get your respect on that. And there'll not be any caste ceiling. Even the logistics industry. Do you think the e-logistics industry, which is because it's so radical today because of the e-com, do you think it's more driven towards the fairer sex? Is that true? It's male dominated. Logistics is an unorganized sector. Somebody said about unorganized sector. Who said that? You said that. So, in the logistics and the e-logistics and the e-com, we are using predictive analysis. It'll take time. You will have to give it that time. What it was from an organized sector to what has come today, it's come in the last few years. Yes? And it will not leave anybody else left, because if somebody has to survive, they will have to get into this. So here, the technology, the change is pushing the organization to get more organized, although it was there in the unorganized sector. It is not a change this way. It's not a sequential change. And in today's technological world, you will not have a sequential change. It will not be linear. It will not be linear. So what you're asking is a linear. There's no linear growth. There's no linear disruption. It's actually reverse. Yes? That's why it's called disruption. If it's a linear growth, it's not disrupted at all. What's disruption in that? It's not a progression, right? What are the other points that you left with? Pardon? HR's future. Okay. On a serious note, HR's future. When I joined this organization, a very senior person, I'm not going to take names, because I'm bound by certain ethics, so I cannot do that. Said, I don't understand HR. And I said, fair enough. You don't understand HR. Just be with me. Today, last year we won the HR award for the first time in the industry. Last year, globally, two of my countries won awards across all the global counterparts of the group. That was my benchmark. And that only can happen when HR sits with business on the same table. Meaning, I will have to talk numbers. I will have to give you a proposal which will benefit your business. I cannot come later and what business tells me, just accept what has to be done and do it. Because then I do not have a contribution as HR. HR is what? HR is a facilitator. People belong to the business. The umbilical cord is joined there. Now, until and unless you make every business partner accountable for his or her business unit, no other shared service function can operate. What do you mean by shared service? Anybody's heard of shared service? No. So what we call as support functions or non-profit functions today have become profit centers, meaning they are attributing to the cost reduction or the optimum utilization. And this is what is the demand of the so-called VUCA or the agile world driven by technology. You are no longer supposed to be sitting as service provider saying, yes, you said that and it will be done. You are supposed to be talking based and basing your decision on numbers. Today, mobilization, if a business tomorrow, today suppose, let's say there's a business volume of 1,000, tomorrow it goes down to 300, what do you do? Only business and operations cannot plan. The HR and the business partner have to plan. So today the fine line, or the luxury of saying that I am probably the HR, which is what is the Miss Dormer, and I am going to probably just fill in something or do an analysis and not give you an impact and not be questioned for the contribution to the numbers is a fallacy. Is dead and gone. So when we have, so in the e-logistics or the e-com today, we have parallelly 5 to 6 business models running. There's no time. The Western market is different from the Northern market. The Northern market is different from the Eastern market. Indian market is different from a Sri Lankan market. What are you going to do? And you're going to wait for the operations to finish it and the supply chain to say that this is what's happening and then HR to come in? I'm sorry, friend. You know, you can't do that. That is not the role of HR anymore. Today, HR stands on the shop floor, on the operations platform. HR gives the numbers, HR does the predictive analysis if the supply chain is doing that for the business forecast. So that is the role of HR which is coming, and it is only going to get more aggressive on that, because that is what is expected from the business. Every business unit needs to justify the amount of cost that you incur or that you're finally hitting on the cash outflow for a month. Today we are in the logistics sector. We are talking about e-platforms. We have got operations force which is very wide. And the couriers, what is the age span? They're probably younger than you all. Right? Within permissible work limits, work age limits. What are they getting trained on? An e-apps? They're getting trained with doodling. Because there's no time. Because their output and their training and their final foot on the field, the time has shrunk that much. You do not have the luxury. But, as we spoke about brand earlier, your service reflects your brand. And therefore HR, as a business partner, is also responsible to ensure that the last mile service reflects your brand for you to sustain a customer, which could be one of you. Because even that has changed. Today the portfolio of customers itself has changed. You do not have major accounts that you can only work on. So with the brand strategy which is changing every day, the HR needs to work on a people strategy to be able to sustain that and keep growing and ensuring that people who are on the field and who are delivering and interacting with the customers internally or externally are competent enough to do that. Who asked the HR question? I don't remember. Was it anything else you were looking at from the HR? So, in today's vocabulary, when you're talking about the aggregators, you're talking about the e-logistics and you're talking about the e-com, the speed of every operation or every function has really, really kind of shrunk, which is what each one of you will need to remember, whether you're joining a company in the e-logistics sector or any other sector. Because e-logistics is a hygiene industry. It underpins and undercuts every product line or every company product that you buy from the market. So if you need to be prepared for a future corporate life, you need to just remember one thing, that what I study, can I apply it? If I look at myself as a customer interacting with the market, can I apply it when I look at probably my friend or my colleague as a customer? Can I look at and interact with my faculty as a customer? Until we try and get down our application to that basic level, there's not going to be any mantra which you're going to be able to apply suddenly when you go to the or make a shift into the corporate. That is for sure. So it's not a difficult journey, it's something which you just need to do it and apply it. And you'll get a response from the other side, for sure. And exactly that, a company you look at when you go and meet them for an interview. They just want you to meet the agile you, that's it. They're not going to meet anybody else. They won't meet your faculty, they won't meet your institute. Nobody's going to go with you. Anybody who's sitting here, it's only you who's going to go. And that's all the company is going to look at. The brand you bring as yourself, who has the agility to be able to deliver in an organization which is changing every day as per business needs, the market needs, and the customer needs. I think that's something which I would leave you all with as a thought. And wish you people all the best.
About VUCA World, brand visibility, e-logistics, technology adaptation, and business innovation. We look forward to have more interaction with you on and off the dial. We were very grateful to have you here.
May I now request Dr. Suresh Chakravarti, Director, Balaji Institute of International Business, to present Momento to our guests.
Thank you, sir.